morning. Welcome again to St. Thomas as we remember and celebrate All Saints today in our service of morning prayer. Grace to you and peace from God our Father, the Lord Jesus Christ. Let us confess our sins against God and our neighbor. Most merciful God, we confess that we have sinned against you in thought, word, and deed, by what we have done and by what we have left undone. We have not loved you with our whole heart. We have not loved our neighbors as ourselves. We are truly sorry and we humbly repent. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, have mercy on us and forgive us, that we may delight in your will and walk in your ways to the glory of your name. Amen. Almighty God, have mercy on you. Forgive you all your sins through our Lord Jesus Christ. Strengthen you in all goodness, and by the power of the Holy Spirit, keep you in eternal life. Amen. Lord, open our lips, and our mouths shall proclaim your praise. Glory to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit, as it was in the beginning, is now, and will be forever. Amen. Worship the Lord in the beauty of holiness. Come, let us adore him. Come, let us sing to the Lord. Let us shout for the joy of the rock of our salvation. Let us come before his presence with thanksgiving and raise a loud shout to him with psalms. For the Lord is a great God and a great King above all gods. In his hands are the caverns of the earth. The heights of the hills are his also. The sea is his, for he made it, and his hands have molded the dry land. Come, let us bow down and bend the knee and kneel before the Lord our Maker, for he is our God. We are his people, sheep of his pasture. Oh, that today you would hearken to his voice. Worship the Lord in the beauty of holiness. Come, let us adore him. Alleluia! Christ, our Passover, has been sacrificed for us. Therefore, let us keep the feast. Not with old leaven, the leaven of malice and evil, but with the unleavened bread of sin, sincerity, and truth. Alleluia. Christ, being raised from the dead, will never die again. Death no longer has dominion over him. The death that he died to sin once and for all. But the life he lives to God. So also consider yourselves dead to sin and alive to God in Jesus Christ our Lord. Hallelujah. Christ has been raised from the dead, the first fruits of those who have fallen asleep. For since by man came death, by man has also come resurrection of the dead. For as Adam all died, but in Christ all shall be made alive. Hallelujah. Glory to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit, as it was in the beginning, is now, and will be forever. Amen. A reading from the book of the Revelation. After this I looked, behold, a great multitude which no man could number, from every nation, from all tribes and peoples and tongues, standing before the throne and before the Lamb, clothed in white robes, with palm branches in their hands, and crying out with a loud voice, "Salvation belongs to our God, who sits upon the throne, and to the Lamb." And all the angels stood around the throne and around the elders and the four living creatures, and they fell on their faces before the throne and worshiped God, saying, "Amen. Blessing and glory and wisdom and thanksgiving and honor and power and might be to our God forever and ever." Then one of the elders addressed me, saying, "Who are these clothed in white robes, and whence have they come?" And I said to him, "Sir, you know." And he said to me, "These are the ones who have come out of the great tribulation. They have washed their robes and made them white in the blood of the Lamb. Therefore, they are before the throne of God and serve him day and night within his temple. And he who sits upon the throne will shelter them with his presence. They shall hunger no more, neither thirst any more. The sun shall not strike them, nor any scorching heat. For the Lamb in the midst of the throne will be their shepherd. He will guide them to springs of living water. God will wipe away every tear from their eyes." The word of the Lord. Canticle 9 is the first song of Isaiah. Surely it is God who saves me. I will trust in him and not be afraid. For the Lord is my stronghold and my sure defense, and he will be my Savior. Therefore you shall draw water with rejoicing from the springs of salvation. And on that day you shall give thanks to the Lord and call upon his name. Make his deeds known among the peoples. See that they remember that his name is exalted. Sing the praises of the Lord, for he's done great things. And this is known in all the world. Cry aloud, inhabitants of Zion. Ring out your joy, for the great one in the midst of you is the Holy One of Israel. Glory to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit, as it was in the beginning, is now, and will be forever. Amen. The Holy Gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ, according to St. Matthew. Jesus saw the crowd, so he went up on a mountainside and sat down, and his disciples came to him. Then he began to teach them. He said, "Blessed are those who are spiritually needy. The kingdom of heaven belongs to them. Blessed are those who are sad. They will be comforted. Blessed are those who are humble. They will be given the earth. Blessed are those who are hungry and thirst for what is right. They will be filled. Blessed are those who show mercy. They will be shown mercy. Blessed are those whose hearts are pure. They will see God. Blessed are those who make peace. They will be called the children of God. Blessed are those who suffer for doing what is right. The kingdom of heaven belongs to them. Blessed are you when people make fun of you and hurt you because of me. You are also blessed when they tell all kinds of lies about you because of me. Be joyful and glad. Your reward in heaven is great. In the same way, people hurt the prophets who lived long ago." The Gospel of the Lord. Those of you that are familiar with the church calendar will know that today we celebrate All Saints Day. How do we know that? Well, because yesterday was Halloween, right? Well, maybe not. It's unfortunate that more people are familiar with Halloween than they are with All Saints Day or All Souls Day. That says a great deal about our society today. Now, the history of All Saints Day is somewhat difficult to trace back because the stories seem to change depending on where you find your information. However, there are another number of things that seem to be consistent. Over 2,000 years ago, festivals were being celebrated honoring the dead. The Feast of All Saints can trace its roots back to Ireland, and it may have evolved from a pagan festival where they honored Samhain, the pagan god Death, Lord of Death. They had bonfires were lit. People wore costumes and masks. Sound familiar? They prayed at the end of the fall harvest, both for those who had died, but also for protection against the evil spirits during the coming year. However, in the 7th century, it was Pope Boniface that celebrated a day when the dead would be remembered. But it wasn't until 835 that Pope Gregory actually placed the day on the church calendar, and it became a celebrated holiday throughout the Holy Catholic Church. As was so often the case, many of our religious holidays came into being on their specific dates in order to counteract or offset some existing pagan holiday. And All Saints Day is an example of this, the same way that Christmas is. You may not know it, but the birth of Christ wasn't celebrated at all until the 3rd century, while Easter was celebrated from the very beginning of time. We're certainly familiar with the date of Easter. That can be traced back because we know from history the celebration of Passover by the Jews. But again, December the 25th was settled on to counter a popular secular holiday that celebrated the children of Rome. All Hallows' Eve, or Halloween, is the day before All Saints' Day. Actually, the word Hallows means saint. So All Hallows' Day became All Saints' Day. And All Hallows' Eve was the night before Halloween. When All Saints' Day was originally meant to remember the canonized saints of the church and those who had been martyred for their faith, we later added All Souls' Day, the day after All Saints' Day, which we remember all those who have died in the faith. In other words, all other Christians who have died. Those are the great cloud of witnesses that Paul describes in his writing. That's the communion of saints, which we're all a part of. One of the things we all need to understand and remember is that all Christians, at the time of their baptism, are called to be saints. Now, most of us may not be canonized by the church, but in the eyes of God, all those who have placed their trust in Him are called to be saints. A saint is one who has been set aside, and that's what you and I have been called to be. Now, it's easy to look at the apostles or Justin Martyr or Joan of Arc or St. Augustine, Mother Teresa, and know that surely these are saints in the eyes of the church. But you know, no one's ever going to call Billy Graham St. Billy. I believe that he certainly has the qualities that we expect to find in a saint. He led the kind of life that we should expect from a saint. But what about you and me? While God may consider me a saint, I doubt that there's anybody else that would agree. And yet that's what each of us is called to be. I remember a line from the English comedy group, Monty Python, that said, "Yep, saints, they just don't make them like that anymore." We tend to look at one another, to ourselves as well, and we think we're just ordinary folk. There's nothing special about us. But I think that's just the point. The message of the incarnation is that we are common, ordinary folk, and we encounter God in the here and now in a living relationship. And we're called to attempt to do the things that Jesus did in our daily lives. That's what saints are called to do. Several years ago, I became aware of a wonderful story. I was at St. Clement's in Berkeley, and a mother shared something her little girl had told her. St. Clement's is a traditional old church with many beautiful stained glass windows that depicted the various apostles, the saints of the church. And it seems that one of the Sunday school teachers had brought her class over to the church to look at the windows and hear a lesson about the saints. And when the little girl got home, she told her mom what she'd learned about saints in Sunday school. And her mom said, "Well, tell me, what is a saint?" This is what the little girl said. She said, "A saint is someone that the light shines through." It was Art Linkletter that said kids say the darkest thing, wasn't it? He was right. But think about that. That's a wonderful statement, is what you and I are called to do and be. You and I are meant to let the love of God shine through our lives so that others can see it. And that's how Paul begins his letter to the Christians in Rome. He wrote, "To all in Rome who are loved of God and called to be saints." In our reading from John's epistle this morning, we read the words, "See what kind of love the Father has given us, that we should be called the children of God." We haven't been called the people of God, or the followers of God, or not even simply the servants of God, although those are certainly proper descriptions. But John reminds us that we're called to be children of God. And on this day, we celebrate the beauty of the reality that we are the children of God, brought into the family of God through adoption at the time of our baptism. You know, kids can say the darndest things at times, but they can also be rather cruel at times. I heard a story about some kids who were outside during recess, and they began to tease one little girl. And while the kids may not understand what it is to be politically correct, sometimes their teasing can be very hurtful. The children were teasing the girl in their class who had been adopted. Someone said, "You don't even know who your parents are." Somebody else said, "You're just adopted." Another cried out, "You don't even have real parents." The little girl turned and began to walk away from her classmates, and then she stopped and she turned back and said, "Oh yeah? Well, I feel bad for you. Even when you were born, your parents felt like they had to keep you. My mom and dad actually wanted me, and I know it because they chose me to be in their family." Kids do say the darndest things, don't they? Think about that. God chose you. He's adopted you. He's given you His name and promised you His inheritance. Our Heavenly Father wanted you and me and His family so much that He sent His Son to make that happen, to make that possible, when He hung on the cross so long ago. And now he calls you his child, and he calls us to be a saint. So this morning we remember all Christians throughout the centuries who have lived their lives faithfully as examples for each of us. You know, we live in a world of instant gratification. There's a commercial for one of the phone companies that says, "We want it all, and we want it now." Now, that pretty well describes where we've been as a society for a number of years now. This mentality isn't something that's just new. Is your internet too slow? Well, get one with a high-speed provider. Nowadays, you can pay at the pump, so you don't have to go in and pay inside. You can eat in your car, you can talk on the phone in your car, because you're always on the move. And who in the world uses snail mail anymore? The only thing we don't seem to have enough of is patience. No patience and no desire to look forward to the things to come. But on this day, let us acknowledge that we don't have it all yet. And you and I are called to walk by faith and rely on God's time with joyful expectation. Our gospel lesson this morning describes the life of sainthood. Those are words that describe what the real life is for a Christian, for a child of God, for a saint. And at the same time, they comfort those who hear those words. Blessed are the poor in spirit, theirs is the kingdom of God. Blessed are those who mourn, they'll be comforted. Blessed are those who hunger and thirst for righteousness. Blessed are those who are persecuted for my name. Those are the words that Jesus used to describe the life of the saint in the world. Those who are in Christ through their baptism. Those who have been fed with the sacraments. Those who have heard and studied his words. Those who have been faithful to his plan for their life. But the words of the Beatitudes don't address instant gratification. They describe those who are dealing with hardships and sorrow. They describe those who are poor of spirit, those who are mourning and struggling and hungry, not so much physically, but spiritually. But what did Jesus promise to his brothers and sisters in Christ, those children of God? Blessed are the poor in spirit, for theirs is the kingdom of God. Blessed are those who mourn, for they shall be comforted. The Beatitudes address real issues in life and promise that God makes to his children that in every instant he's there to carry us through. But again, I ask the question, what does this morning's lesson have to do with our remembrance of those who have gone on before us? What's the lesson for you and I this morning? Each week in the Creed, we say he will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. We profess our belief in one who is God of the living and the dead. And while none of us looks forward to our death, we cling to the belief that like Christ, we too will be raised up and be with God forever. The Old Testament begins with the words, "In the beginning, God." In the book of Revelation, we hear the words, "I am the Omega, the Alpha and the Omega, the beginning and the end." God was not only here in the beginning, but he'll be there in the end. We might say, in the beginning, God, and in the end, God. The God that we worship this morning is not only the giver of life, but the creator of life. He's also the giver of eternal life. I don't know if the words of Jesus in this morning's lesson are meant to describe the joys of our earthly life or if they're a promise for life to come. Theirs is the kingdom of heaven. They'll be comforted. They'll be filled. They'll receive mercy. They'll see God. They'll be called the children of God. Jesus said, "Rejoice and be glad, for your reward will be great in heaven." Was Jesus telling the people that they might expect here on earth, or was he describing what his followers could look forward to in the afterlife? Or maybe a bit of both. What's death like? No one really knows. Oh, there have been those who have had those near-death experiences and later described having seen a bright light or something similar, and I don't discount those experiences. But that still doesn't fully tell us what death is like, does it? When we look at the account of Jesus' resurrection, the gospel stories, we see that Jesus was resurrected into a new body when he appeared to his disciples. He could walk through doors. He could appear and disappear. They didn't even recognize him at first in his resurrected body. But after they touched him and ate with him, they recognized him as the same Jesus whom they loved and followed and even disobeyed at times. The idea of immortality, I suspect, is attractive to us because it acts as if eternity is something that we possess as human beings. But the idea of the resurrection can be humbling because it's a pure gift to mere mortals like you and I. Immortality, I believe, assumes that we can continue on in the next life. If you enjoy gardening in this life, you'll be able to garden in the next, but there won't be any weeds. If you play golf, you can always get a tee time with pristine greens and no traps. If you enjoy reading, there'll always be time to sit down and read a book. But the resurrection that John describes in the book of Revelations promises a whole new world, radically different from this world, because then we will come into the very presence of God. I believe that heaven will be a healed, restored, wonderfully refashioned world. And in that new world, God will wipe away every tear. There'll be no more sadness, only no more grief or death, because he's promised a new heaven and a new earth. Anyone who's ever said, you know, this is just as good as it gets, is someone who has a very low expectation of what God can do. Think about that. You and I have no idea how good it can get, how good it will get, because we know and believe that in the end, God's going to get what he wants for each of his adopted children. This morning, we come to God's altar, celebrating the sacraments in remembrance of me. Let's also remember that the saints have gone on before. Let us remember the ways that God has been faithful to each of us. John wrote in the Revelations of a day when there would be no more tears, there'd be no more pain. It may be difficult for any of us this morning to recall the lives of friends or loved ones who have gone before us without some tears and pain. But Jesus would remind us this morning that we should rejoice and be glad, for their reward is great in heaven. John said, "Blessings and glory and wisdom and thanksgiving and honor and power and might be to Almighty God." So this morning, as we remember and celebrate the lives of all the saints, let us remember that you and I are called to be children of God. And God's good all the time. Join with me in the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord. He was conceived by the power of the Holy Spirit and born of the Virgin Mary. He suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to the dead. On the third day, he rose again. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. The Lord be with you. Let's pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. Thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. Save your people, Lord, and bless your inheritance. Govern and uphold them now and always. Day by day we bless you. We praise your name forever and ever. Lord, keep us from all sin today. Have mercy upon us. Lord, have mercy. Lord, show us your love and mercy, for we put our trust in you. And you, Lord, is our hope, and we shall never hope in vain. Let us pray. Almighty God, you have knit together your elect in one communion and fellowship in the mystical body of your Son, Christ our Lord. Give us grace so to follow your blessed saints in all virtuous and godly living, that we may come to those inevitable joys that you have prepared for those who truly love you through Jesus Christ our Lord. O God, the author of peace and lover of concord, you know his eternal life. You know you his eternal life to serve you is perfect freedom. Defend us, your humble servants, in all assaults of our enemies, that we, assuredly trusting in your defense, may not fear the power of any adversity through the might of Jesus Christ. Lord God Almighty and ever-living Father, you have brought us in safety to this new day. Preserve us with your almighty power, that we may not fall into sin, nor be overcome by adversity, and in all we do direct us to the fulfilling of your purpose. God, you have made of one blood all peoples of the earth, and sent your blessed Son to preach peace to those who are far off and those who are near. Grant that people everywhere may seek after you and find you. Bring the nations under your fold, pour out your Spirit upon all flesh, and hasten the coming of your kingdom. Lord Jesus Christ, you stretched out your arms of love on the hard wood of the cross, and that everyone might come within the reach of your saving embrace. So clothe us with your Spirit, that we, reaching forth our hands in love, may bring those who do not know you to the knowledge and love of you for the honor of your name. Amen. Today on All Saints Day, we remember those who have gone on before, being part of that great cloud of witnesses who are saints in your eyes. Remember Malcolm, Carol, Kalita, Marion, Clara, Sydney, John, Gan, Rudy, Bill, Nancy, Dan, Gary, Linda, Evelyn, Malia, Billy, Nikki, Mark, Jim, Joe, Anna, Christine, Peter, Stanley, Helena, Josephine, Mary, and Veronica. Eternal Lord God, you hold all souls in life. Give to your whole church in paradise and on earth your light and your peace. And grant that we, following the good example of those who have served you here and now are at their rest, may at the last enter with them into your unending joy through Jesus Christ our Lord. Almighty God, Father of all mercies, we, your unworthy servants, give you humble thanks for all your goodness and loving kindness to us and to all whom you have made. We bless you for your creation, preservation, and all the blessings of this life, but above all for your immeasurable love and the redemption of the world by our Lord Jesus Christ, for the means of grace and for the hope of glory. And we pray, give us such an awareness of your mercies that with truly thankful hearts we may show forth your praise, not only with our lips, but in our lives, by giving up ourselves to your service and by walking before you in holiness and righteousness all our days. Through Jesus Christ our Lord, to whom with you and the Holy Spirit be honor and glory throughout all ages. Amen. Almighty God, you've given us grace at this time with one accord to make our common supplication to you. You have promised through your well-beloved Son that when two or three are gathered together in your name, you will be in the midst of them. Fulfill now, O Lord, our desires and petitions as may be best for us, granting us in this world knowledge of your truth, and in the age to come, life everlasting. As we conclude our service this morning, I invite you to meditate for a moment on your act of spiritual communion. My Jesus, I believe that you're present in the holy sacrament of your body and blood. I love you above all things, and I desire to receive you into my soul. Since I cannot at this time receive you sacramentally, I invite you to come spiritually into my heart. I embrace you as if you were here with me, and I unite myself with you fully. Never permit me to be separated from you. Amen. The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with us all evermore. Amen. Let us bless the Lord. Thanks be to God. Hallelujah.
Softly and tenderly, Jesus is calling. Calling for you and for me. He's waiting and watching. Watching.